Now we're going really deep into the experience. Whose turn is it now to share the experience?
It's your turn.
Is it my turn? Yeah, okay. So the experience that I've been going through lately is we're finally in football season in full swing.
Woohoo! Go Dolphins.
You're a Dolphin fan?
Hello, I'm from Florida.
That's right, Florida. Sheesh, I thought you would have known better.
No. We are 3-1.
Are you?
Okay,
did
3-1. It didn't happen.
Okay.
We're going to give them the one. That's it. But we're talking Super Bowl.
Okay. Yeah.
Because when you're talking Dolphins, you are talking Super Bowl.
Yeah, you're talking, they're going to have seats to the Super Bowl. I don't think they're going
to. It's about to get violent in here.
Am I? Well, don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm a Chargers fan. And
well, sorry for you.
You should be. As always, it's so weird being a Charger fan because I really feel that, like, we get just shitted on all the time, and that's kind of our role.
You have bad players.
We do. We have all right players.
No,
our players should be like the greatest players on earth. But then, for some reason, they end up, you know, messing it up at the very end. So I'm dealing with that. You know,
now, do you think it's your coaching staff, or do you think it's the actual players themselves?
Okay, damn, we're about to get deep. I might get some hate mail for this, and that's fine. I want to blame the coaching staff, but we just had a regime change this year, and the coaching staff is brand new. And here's the thing with coaching staffs: it takes about 2 to 3 years for a coach's ideology to really be ingrained in a team, and for the team to really embrace that.
Right.
I do believe it's time for our quarterback situation to kind of see itself to another quarterback. I like Philip Rivers, but you know, he just whines too much, and that really bothers me.
He throws
tantrums on the field, and it's just like, come on, dude,
throw the ball.
Yeah, you're getting paid to throw the ball, not to have a tantrum. So I'm kind of going through that right now. Just
runs,
you know,
to the sideline. I don't understand the play.
Yeah, so I'm going through that right now of going through the football experience. I enjoy it, though. You know, even here's the thing. People take sports way too seriously. When I watch the game, it's like, okay, I'm here to watch the Chargers. And if they lose, hey, guess what? They lose. If they win.
That's because you're not investing money in it.
I'm not investing money, but I'm investing my love. Because when I love a team, I'm very monogamous. It's like, okay, like the Dodgers. I love the Dodgers, and I'm happy that they're having a killer season this year. They're phenomenal. Phenomenal season, so I'm really happy about that. But you know, I want my life to be perfect, where it's like my football team and my baseball team both have stellar seasons. To me, that's a good year. But like I said, just because your teams make it or whatever, that shouldn't reflect on you in any way, because at the very end of the day, these teams are profiting on your love.
Right.
You know, so when I watch a team, I just watch them. And it's funny, a lot of people are like, why don't you bet on sports? I'm like, because that ruins the sport for me. You know, I'm here to watch the game. I'm not here to lose money. You know, if you invest money into watching a game, then you're a sucker. Because it's supposed to be for entertainment, not for profit.
All right. Yeah, I agree.
That's been my experience.
You know, it's funny. My sister is a horse breeder, and she feels that anytime that I'm watching a race and her boyfriend's son is like the number two jockey in the world, Joey Bravo. Anytime that I'm watching a race and he is falling behind, it's my fault.
So that's ridiculous.
Yeah. So I'm like the, I don't, what are those like little
scapegoat?
You know,
like a voodoo lady or something?
Yeah, no, it's like, you know, those little dolls that you put on there and you just like shake their hair and you blow on them. It's like a little troll thing.
Voodoo dolls.
Yeah, well, that's how my sister feels about me. You know, if I'm watching, she's like, are you watching right now? I'm like, yes. Turn around. Don't look at the screen. Why? Why is it my fault if he's falling behind? It's the horse. It's not me.
Exactly.
You know, but, you know, somehow that it becomes my fault.
Look, people, we all love to believe that we are the secret key ingredient in our team. We're not. Just because we, you know, believe in luck or whatever, guess what? You know, attending the game does not have an outcome. The only The only thing that affects the team is the player. And if you're not a player, guess what? You're not affecting the team.
Yeah, my whole family is very, very superstitious.
Really?
Extremely superstitious.
Are you superstitious?
You know, I am a little bit because that's how I was raised. And, you know, I would walk into the house and people would spit on my head. And it was like all these sort of blessings. You got to turn this way. And
I would just spit out your head too. I'm like, oh, Max, that's just a blessing. It's fine.
No. I didn't understand really how that became a blessing, but somehow, like, saliva.
Dune. I think Dune is that way.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's another planet in a fictitious world. But
well, I'm kind of from another
from
planet.
Dune?
Arcturian. I'm Arcturian, I believe. I guess I'm a little superstitious. You know, I believe a lot in energy. People would call that super natural thinking.
I don't think so. I don't see why that would be supernatural, only because energy, everything runs off of energy.
Right, it does.
You know,
it
and does. That's just
see
fact.
Your energy, like
my aura.
Yeah, I can
read. What color is my aura right now? Is it Charger blue? Come on, baby.
It's not. Oh, it's damn. Not. I'm sorry.
Dodger blue? It's, I'll settle for Dodger blue.
It's aqua. It's orange and aqua.
What's that?
Go dolphin.
God damn you, Max. So we just shared an experience. Ross, would you care to share an experience that you're going
through? Of course, I've been sitting on the couch wondering what experience I should... I shouldn't say that.
No, that's great.
Anyhow, and I didn't know what to do. I wouldn't know how personal I wanted to get, but since you brought up a sports analogy... I did have a thing that happened to me yesterday. I felt a little bad about it. I teach this class at Gold's Gym, a group fitness class called Body Pump, right?
Body Pump.
Body Pump. Yeah. Anyhow, and it's I teach every once so often, and last night I was gonna go to the class anyway, but I get a phone call from the guy who was really the instructor and asked me if I could basically sub for him for the first half, and I said sure, I'll be happy. Basically because he was running late. So I get there and I'm all ready to go, and it's basically, you know, you've got an hour to get through all this stuff and you really can't dawdle, you have to kind of be on it, right? So I'm about, I don't know, a minute from downbeat basically, you know, I've got my weights and all, it's basically you're lifting weights to choreographed weightlifting to music, right?
Okay.
And it sounded, when I first saw it, I go, wow, this is so freaking gay. I'm not ever doing this. And then I actually started doing it and started digging it. And then now I'm an instructor. And it actually, a little sidetracked it, but it's actually improved my musicianship.
Has it?
Yeah, it got me out of my head and trust my body more. Made me move. It's kind of like dancing or something, you know, where you actually have to move in time. But when you do big, gross muscle movements in time, that's different than doing this in time. And your brain is a very bad timekeeper because your brains can think very fast and slow. But your body's much better, you know, because there's actual movement, you know. Anyway, that's beside the point. So yesterday, I'm about to push go, and this girl waddles in, and
waddles.
Well, that's waddles, yeah. That was waddles. Actually that was a Freudian slip. That's kind of accurate, actually. Anyway, and apparently now, in order to become a certified instructor, you have to do a video and all these kinds of things, right? Which I've done a long time ago. So apparently she's doing her video this week, and she said, did Chris tell you? I go, no, what? He goes, well, I'm going to be, you know, what's called, teaching the class with me, right? There's a name for it. Yeah. Mirroring. Yeah. Like mirroring the thing. I go, great. We got to go. And she goes, but yeah, but I'm working on, you know, Body Pump 86, you know, and I go, and I'm about to push, like, I think it was like 74 or something. I go, we're not doing that. We're doing this one. Now, the part that I felt kind of bad was, I didn't realize it, but you wear a little microphone on your head, right? So I'm basically shooting her down in front of about 35 people, right?
You have
with
an
the
audience.
Microphone on, right?
You have an audience.
Right. And I'm just going, no, we're not doing that. and her shoes looks like, and she's obviously a bit insecure anyway. And we had a little bit of a conversation that was pretty short, and I said, Chris is coming anyway, and because she was misinformed, thinking we were going to do the whole class. Anyway, so I kind of shot her down in front of everybody, and then she pouts and goes out and sits out and waits, you know. And the vibe in the room was just destroyed. Oh, I mean, the energy in the room was just like, and I just felt like a big asshole up there, like, I'm going, what happened? And I didn't realize that I was like, you know, talking in the mic. And I kind of, it took about four tracks before the room and the energy in the room kind of just started to equalize and just get a little bit normal again, you know. And then the other guy shows up, and then she got to do her thing with him. And then I go afterwards to talk to her. I said, look, you know, you can't show up a minute before downbeat and expect the world to just kind of bow to you in this situation, you know. And then immediately she goes, don't tell me when I should not show up. I thought, well, that's an interesting approach. And I thought, it's interesting how, because obviously I had to be the bad guy in her mind. And of course, I wanted her to be the bad guy in my mind. And that's just human nature, you know. And I thought, well, she is kind of playing the victim role here, you know. And because it's like, I'm going to be wronged. You wronged me. I have to do this video, and this is my last chance, and you shot me down. And then I did feel kind of bad about that. And so I did offer it on Fridays. I offered her, she could have my Friday slot if her thing. But I felt like I redeemed myself a little bit. But anyhow, I'm not used to being an asshole. So,
you're not?
Not really.
That's surprising.
Whoa. Max, do you know something? Do you know?
Obviously, if I was used to this, this wouldn't have even been a thought, right? I mean, I wouldn't even have thought twice about it. No, but I did feel, I think I'm going, was I, first of all, my whole thought was I being an asshole? I don't think I really was. But then I thought, well, I could have been more elegant about that. I could have been certainly more diplomatic and, you know, and I still wasn't about to do 86. I mean, so that was, there's an experience.
That's totally an experience.
Is that a totally experience?
That's
totally.
Okay. An experience.
Okay, a little experience. Okay.
Found out a little bit about yourself.
Yeah,
I did. I learned a little bit about myself, you know. I've been very introspective lately. I've learned a lot of things about myself lately that aren't very flattering. Like? That's a whole other story. Sure. Well, that's a different show.
Tell me. You got some BO? I mean, what?
No. I'm not sure how to.
Deep thought with Ross.
Well, here's the thing. Okay, I can tell you a little bit about it. I mean, where to begin? I sort of been in this relationship with this woman for, God, it's been about 6 years, but the last 2 years it's been on and off, and it's been really crazy. And we basically would break up for like 3 months, and then we kind of fall back into it and we break up. And I realized even the last year of this sort of little on again, because I'd be off and I'd be so happy, and then I kind of slip back into this, and it was just really it's convenient but I knew it was dysfunctional, you know, but there's always in my mind there was always some little unfinished bit of business, you know, and that was kind of the hook. Now I didn't realize this consciously, that was the hook that would get me in back, you know, and I realized even last year that it's sort of like it was a drug. This was sort of like, I don't do drugs. I don't even drink. I don't even eat sugar. At least I try not. Once in a while, I'll indulge.
There's your biggest problem. Not eating sugar.
No, but I try to eat healthy. You know, I try to do these things, you know. And
stay away from popcorn, though.
I love popcorn.
Apparently, that makes you very randy.
I'm randy anyway. It doesn't matter. I don't eat popcorn for that. For those of you, for those people who don't speak British, look up the word randy. anyway, so I had, and now you got to throw another element in this mix into this whole thing is there's sort of an alcohol element that's thrown into on her side that's gotten like progressively out of hand, right? And which would never was when we started, that was not even part of the equation. And it's just sort of gotten more and more. And then I realize, and then about a year ago, see, I'm really going to open my shit up. I shouldn't be doing this on radio.
you absolutely should be doing this
exactly.
On radio.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, anyway.
Let him talk.
So I started going to these Al-Anon meetings like about a year and a half ago, actually. And I'd go to these, and I'd sort of hear people's story, and I go, well, I can relate to that. But the thing about Al-Anon meetings is like, it's not like being an AA or something, because that's a really clear, like, what am I recovering from? What about me is fucked up, you know?
Right.
What am I dealing with, really? You know, and then people would say, well, you're dealing with the fact that you've been dealing with alcoholics your whole life, and that's normal. Actually, it was never explained to me that simply, actually. That's sort of a new thing, but that's basically what it is. And so I'm going, because I don't partake in any of that, you know, at all. And I'm like a straight arrow kind of guy. And so I'm thinking, where's my, where am I, what am I recovering from? It's not like you're an alcoholic and you start drinking. That's an obvious, you've fallen off the wagon. It's pretty clear as to what your goal is, right? But I'm thinking, what is my goal? What am I, and I've been struggling with that for a long time, right? So this is my epiphany. This has happened maybe, probably about 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks. I mean, where it got so out of hand, right? And yet, I mean, with this, and she got really like the point where she was inebriated and intoxicated like all the time and just vile and mean and just like really abusive to me. And I'm like, all of a sudden I am the devil, right? And of course, then I realized everybody in her life is always the devil because that's part of that victim alcoholic kind of behavior, right? Anyhow, and then I realized, this is where I realized how fucked up I am in this regard. It's like, that was kind of what pulled me in. It's like, I don't want to be that guy. So I have to fix that. I can't just leave it like that. I can go, all right, I'm the asshole. You have a good life. I'm out of here. Because I have to like, though, I want to fix that. And I want to, and that was always the pull. And I realized, oh my God, that's this yin and yang thing or whatever. Not, that's not the right word, but this pull and this ebb and flow, this Strongman-drong that's going on in our lives, right? And I thought, once I realized that I was kind of addicted to this weird dysfunctional behavior that goes right back to childhood and all my little growing up with alcoholic fathers and so forth, that I realized that's that wound I'm trying to heal, and I'm doing it all wrong. and so that was a moment of clarity for me, where I just went, oh, it means I can walk away and I can be the asshole, if you know, in her mind. Of course, no one else thinks that. Everyone else is going, dude, what are you doing here? everyone else, and like afterwards they go, like, why have you put up with that shit? You're, no sane person would do that. And I go, yeah, but I always felt like there was some unfinished bit of business, you know? And so anyway, that was that's probably the most heavy thing that's been gone on in my life in the last year.
You know, that it's interesting because Ross actually has come to me for Reiki. And
really, Ross, you come.
It was totally worth it.
Okay, I've always been skeptical.
I would say this Reiki. By accident. She did spill all kinds of what was that stuff?
Now,
yeah,
it was pretty funny. Yeah. What was that?
Lipstick?
Oh, no, that was aromatherapy juice.
No, there was a little, you know, stuck in the lid, and yeah, it just spilled.
It was endeared. I was endeared by that.
Aw, and that's so. Anyway, speaking of the victim rescuer position, because you're a rescuer,
apparently.
And that happens a lot. You know, when you are dating people that fall into that same pattern, for you, you have this need to fix, and it's never. Things are never finished because you haven't dealt with your past, and you know, so you have a hard time being in the present, and that's the word that, you know, is so important to everybody, is to be present right here, right now, all the time. And forgive your past, and you know, for tomorrow, you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, so you have no business being there, so just live now.
Right. Well, that's the one thing that I always liked about music. There's two things in my life that put me in the present, you know, and one of them's music. and that's the thing I love about it, actually. Right. Especially when you're really in the zone, you know, and it happens to me when I'm playing and when I'm conducting. Mm-hmm. Even when I'm writing sometimes. Like, there's a lot of times where I look at the clock and it's 8:00, and next day I look over and it's like 1:30, and I go, wow, how'd that happen? You know what I mean? Because you're just in the zone and you're, you know, you're doing your thing. But that's when I'm told, and of course, I think there's a tremendous intoxication about being in the present. And I heard something, just since we're subject, I heard a guy once talk about why we romanticize war. Because, well, obviously, nobody really likes
it. War sucks.
Yeah, pretty much. No, there's no really a lot of, good things you can say about war. But one thing that does do when you're in a life and death situation, because like people who are in it tend to bond and they do all kinds, you know. Yeah. And they romanticize it on some level. And part of it is because you are absolutely forced to be 100% present. Because if you're not, you get killed. Right. You know what I mean? And so, you know, music's not quite as, the consequences aren't quite as extreme. But it's almost like that. Some cases, depending on your audience, you know, you know, you have to certainly be present, or you'll, you know, crash and burn. Something will happen.
Yeah, I mean, everybody seems to have this. Not everybody, but a lot of people, they fall back into old relationships and old patterns because it's comfortable.
Sure.
And they feel like it's not finished.
Yeah. And, well, it's finished now, boy.
Well, after today's radio show, it's finished.
It's like, you know, and even after, I get it. I mean, but just the awareness was so correcting, you know. I had another experience. It was interesting where just the awareness of it made was just an instant change, you know. I'd gone to this little seminar. I went to a Tony Robbins seminar, and he was talking about, you know, neuro-associated conditioning, all those things he talks about. Anyhow, and so I kind of, all that stuff's kind of fresh in my head, and I go to a recording session, and I'm playing bass. I'm doing this thing where I had to solo and stuff, you know. And it was for a singer-songwriter person, and then, so I'm sitting there waiting between takes, and she leans over and says, "You sound great." Okay. Be happy about that. And immediately I got pissed off. Went, "Fuck you." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah." I thought, wow, that's fucked up. Why would I feel that way? And I realized my whole life, the good news is my whole life people have been saying, "Oh, you sound great." And in my mind, when people say that, I'm going, "You're an idiot. You don't know what the hell you're talking about. Screw you. I suck. Don't. If you knew anything, you know I'd suck."
Do you think that they're just like yes men?
Well, there's no, I think, there are those kind of people, but these are just people. I mean, there's like people who just go, "Wow, you sound great." You know, I'm like, whatever. And in my mind, I was so self-critical of my playing about who I was that I would always just turn that around and made it into like a negative. Like, well, you know, you don't know anything. You know, and so in my brain, I twisted that around and I thought, wow, that's messed up, right? And so when I realized that, I mean, it was instantly self-correcting. I thought, okay, wow, I realized what my brain has done to myself. And I she was sincere. She was like, "Sound great. I like what you did." You know, it doesn't have to be more than that. It doesn't have to be, you know, it's not, you know, I don't have to like become, I was so afraid of like thinking, you know, maybe my ego will get so big if I believe the bullshit that people tell me, you know. But, there's a difference between appreciating it and appreciating that people appreciate you.
Yeah.
And then buying into some sort of fantasy that there's some that you.
You know, there's actually a term for that. It's called musical dysmorphia. So you believe that you are not as good as you are, you know, and a lot of people, Michael Jackson, they all had this problem, and when they would go on stage, they would throw up.
Wow.
So it wasn't stage fright. It's dysmorphia.
Because I do think there's a side of you, especially when you're young. I mean, you kind of need, in order to really grow, you have to have that. You have to have that ambition and the desire and the critical thinking to say, all right, this could be better and I can improve. But at the same time, you do have to enjoy the process, Because I think I was so eager to be good at something in my life that I was like, you know, that I really wasn't allowing myself to enjoy the process. I was just, I had to practice. Yeah. I had to just do it, you know, because I knew it.
Right.
I had to, you know, that's a little bit out of a dysfunctional side, Sure. But I think I kind of got over that. That's another good moment where I had a moment of like clarity, like, oh, okay.
Well, let's talk about the things that you are good at.
Oh, what's that? I'm
curious too.
It's certainly not self-image. It's not my self-image. Is not my good.
And
point.
I don't know if I'd want to like teach a class with him or anything, because you know I wouldn't want to waddle in there and teach a class. That would be pretty bad.
you don't waddle, man.
But well, lately I've been waddling.
Have you been gaining weight? Or?
I have.
Is it water weight or
no? You know what? I stopped working out as hard because I have a back injury,
right?
And so that's what it is. And since the moment that I got here, which has been almost 5 years now, I gained 27 pounds.
Oof!
And for my body, I mean, I'm still 125 pounds.
No way! You're not 125 pounds. I don't. You're not. Your tits are like at least 50 pounds.
I think there's a compliment in there.
Wow.
I take it as a compliment.
I'm 125 pounds. So, yeah, I was under 100 pounds when I got here.
Wow.
Holy cow.
And I'm 5'7" and a half. To a lot of people, that would be the wrong weight. You know, you would think that, you know,
well,
I should be heavier.
Not overweight.
Well, yeah. Thanks. But, you know, I make money off of the way I look.
Yeah.
So on screen, I have to stay thin or I'm going to look heavier. You know, the camera adds
10 pounds.
It's not
flattering.
It's
pounds
very,
either.
Very, very true. Yeah. And I wish they would, you know, talk about the fact that, you know, I've got 10 pounds of wrinkles on me now. What the hell is that? I'm not comfortable
with that. I just had a $1 billion idea. We develop cameras that make you look that subtract 10 pounds.
Yes, and they should okay. be right there all the time.
We'll be billionaires, I'm telling
yes,
you.
Yes, I love it. I love it.
Probably, there'll be an app for that.
No, but getting back to, Ross over here, you have a band. Not
right.
a band. It's
you
not
create
a,
music.
It's not a band, though.
Is it an orchestra?
It's an orchestra. It's a 30-piece orchestra these days.
Yeah, but it's even more than that.
Oh.
It's a way of life. These musicians are the most bizarre individuals I've ever met.
By the way, we should give out the websites because through this whole thing, we haven't given you a plug, which, you know, you totally deserve. Ross-Wright, WRIGHT.com. That's RossWright-.com. And then the Orchestre Surreal.com. Go visit them there. And I'm going to have all the links on the show notes so you can be fans of the Facebook and so forth. That's all the admin stuff. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I met Orchestre Surreal.
Isn't it Orchestre?
I believe it's Orchestra.
Right. Is it Orchestre? Because there's no A.
Orchestre. I mean, Orchestre is like some French way of doing it, but Orchestre
That's
Surreal
gay.
Is usually the way it's okay. pronounced. I don't know why I decided to
You're
spell
feeling
it
fancy.
That way. Yeah, and it's like just to make it that much harder to find, you know, in Amazon or CD Baby or whatever. You know. Yeah, just to mess you up just one bit more. And then, of course, having a pseudonym is Elvis Schoenberg.
Oh, my right. God.
And not Ross Wright. I branded myself as Elvis Schoenberg. I wasn't thinking, you know.
Are you Jewish?
No, not Jewish. I mean, no, that's the thing. But
are you an Elvis fan?
Not particularly. No, I thought it was a funny name because of the two. It was kind of the basis of my band is like two extreme opposites. You know, you've got King of Rock and Roll here. You know, and then of course, he's sort of the king of dodecaphonicism or. Dada or modern classical music or something. I mean, you got Arnold Schoenberg, and of course, most people don't even know who Arnold Schoenberg is, you know?
I have no idea.
Yeah, so the joke gets lost on a lot of people, you know, and they go, well, and, you know, but those who get it find it very funny.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, and, but there's like, for example, we do a 12-tone arrangement I wrote of Blue Suede Shoes. It's on the, that's our first record. There's that on that record is the
yeah we have three
shoes.
Records in front of us we're yeah, bound to get it right man
yeah one's an all Hendrix record we do Hendrix songs.
Oh that's cool
well it's sort of Hendrix record there's songs Hendrix played not necessarily ones he always wrote a few that he didn't write so that's the joke
well, wanted to talk to you about conducting because a lot of people think conducting the conductor that there's no need it's all show it's all you know the orchestra has their movements in front of them and the conductor's there just for kind of eye candy you
what?
Know I'm telling you there's a big a lot
what?
Of people
in
that
some
believe
cases,
this
in some cases that could be the case I mean you know in some cases if you just count a tune off and there's drums and there's no really anything particularly tricky about the tune you're not like the conductor's there to like In traditional classical music, that music's not really in rigid time, a lot of it. You know? And so the conductor is there to keep everybody together and to tell you when to come. You know, when the percussionist's been sitting there for 300 bars and he's got to bash a cymbal, it's kind of nice to give him a heads up. Like, here we go. Yeah, you know what I mean? Because he's got to sit there, you know. those kind of things. So you're directing traffic a little bit.
And I got a burp.
You got a burp? Go for it. Nice.
How was that?
Can you do the alphabet when you do that?
No, I can't. I can't.
That's gross.
Can you guys burp a little bit better than me? Or?
I actually can burp really well. I'm not good at it, though. I respect.
Thank you.
Max.
Thank
much.
You. Somebody does. Not
but
true.
I used to really
not
enjoy true. Going in burping contests. I was as a kid, I was something like quite good.
Really?
Why? I was a guy. Why? I was a teenage boy. I mean, come on. It's just part of, you know.
I don't know. Well, I was brought up in a much different world.
You weren't a teenage boy. That's all. Yes.
Well, I wasn't a teenage boy. I wasn't even allowed to speak, let alone burp. That would be like.
What happened?
Oh
that we ruined you. You started
you
talking, and then.
I know. I shouldn't ever been out of the house. I was it.
Now, studies. We do have Ross Wright with us. Ross-Wright.com. The Orchestre. Surreal.com. That's another website where you can find them at. And like I said, show notes, we're going to have all the links to the Facebook, the Twitters, and all that fun stuff. Now, we dabbled a little bit with the orchestra stuff. Wanted to touch real quickly on the novel that you did write. Max is going to show that for the camera. I find it extremely interesting because you're dabbling in something very cool, which is sci-fi. Sci-fi is one of those genres that I completely love because you could do so much with it. And your brain can just explore so many different realms. Tell me a little bit about the book and the concept of it.
Where to start? I got the idea a long time ago, actually, when I was working on a cruise ship. You know,
awesome.
I worked at a cruise ship as a musician right out of college, you know. But the idea of, I guess just all these, in a cruise ship you have a very hierarchical kind of thing, and there's all these little, you're stuck in this little world, right? And then I like the idea of what would happen if you lived in an environment where all of a sudden the gravity increased, like, you know, all of a sudden, it's like this was 10 times heavier. Everything was just like, you know, you adapted to that, right? And then you come back to Earth, it'd be like you're walking on the moon. Like you would,
and you're super strength.
Exactly. So that was sort of the premise of kind of what started the book, right? It's basically, in some ways, it's a glorified comic book almost. but what makes it not a comic book?
No pictures,
for starters. Yeah. It's really thick, you know. And here's, I'll tell
and
you.
I was looking for them.
Yeah, you're looking for those pictures, man. And then what I learned a lot about what it is to write a novel, you know, in writing one. Like, I remember when I wrote my first symphony, it was like, I learned what it's about, what a symphony is about. When you actually write one, you go, I get it. I can't really describe it. It's like a thing, you kind of get it after you do it. You know? Same with a novel. How do you get information that you care about out, you know, but through the eyes of the characters and in the situation? So there's a lot of political intrigue. There's a lot of, I kind of do a lot of bashing of corporate America and a lot of corruption and a lot of, you know, so obviously my political voice is very strong in there, but it's not me. It's not the author talking. It's the situation and how it works. And so that's the part that I kind of like about the book. And as far as the sci-fi element, it's actually very much a coming-of-age story about a kid who gets into himself in a very much a hero's journey. He gets himself in a situation where he has to transform and does a lot of things, and is forced to deal with a lot of obstacles, a lot of chasing, a lot of fighting, a lot of bad guys, and all that kind of stuff. And also, what I like. What I wanted the character to be a bit conflicted in, like, what, there's the big question of what is right and wrong, because that's not always such a clear thing, you know, depending on your perspective. You know, the bad guy kind of states his case as to not why he's a bad guy. He's not a two-dimensional bad guy. I always loved, my favorite bad guy was Salieri in Amadeus.
Oh,
because he's a great bad guy, because there's a side of him who just loves Mozart. He admires him so much, and he's so jealous of him, hates him so much for the same reason. For the same reason he admires him, he also hates him, you know. And he'll do whatever he can to backstab him. But he also kind of wants to be a part of his success, you know, and like, so he's really conflicted, you know, but I love the complexity of that, you know. Anyway, and so my bad guy is not quite as quite that developed, but he sees himself not as a bad guy, but as just the way the world is. There's people who are the doers of the world, and that's just the way it is. And the rest of the people are kind of like pawns that need to be told what to do, and the winners take the spoils of and that's the hierarchy that's always existed. And you can either join them or you can fight them, but you always lose. You know? And he sort of offers my character the opportunity to be in his club, which is like billionaire club, exploiting people and all that stuff. And of course, that's if you're a young kid who has nothing, you know, that's a very enticing opportunity, you know. But
sign me up immediately.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, but then he also sees that there's a downside to that too. And so, I mean, he has to struggle with that. And I like that part of the book. And the fun part of the book also was the sci-fi aspect of I get to invent shit. Like, and here's, okay, it took me a while to write this book. When I first started writing this book, I had all these like little, like, you know, I just would, like, you know, what essentially didn't exist at the time was, an iPad didn't exist yet. So I basically had to invent the iPad, right, for my book. And then all of a sudden the iPad comes out, I go, damn, I got to hurry up and publish this book before it becomes a historical book as opposed to a futuristic book. But there's like nanobots and there's all kinds of like technology things that the characters all have that are kind of fun, you know, jetpacks and all these kinds of gadgets that are just fun.
That's not really sci-fi. I mean, all of that stuff is...
It's just kind of real life stuff.
Yeah, right now. So.
I know, that's what I'm saying. That's why he's got to get it out.
But, I mean, do you see this being adapted for film?
Yeah, I'm already writing a screenplay for it. It's in process. No, it's totally set up for a film. It's very cinematic.
Now, I noticed that, you know... That it has the chronicles of Ethan Stone. So does that mean you have more adventures?
There's certainly more available. Yes, I mean that was the idea. That
okay. Yeah. Now here's my pitch. I think that Ethan Stone should be listening to a really cool show called The Tortoise and Hare Experience.
Okay, I got him that.
In the book, you know.
Sure. While the Orchestra Surreal is being interviewed, right?
Yeah. That should be cool.
Yeah, well, they're playing on it. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So, we met at a Comic Con, and are you a comic fan?
Yeah, as a kid, I was. You know, I still kind of. I don't like own comic books really. Mm-hmm. I don't. You know, I like to.
What?
I'm not a big reader of comic books, but I've always like. You know, as a kid, I was into them to a certain degree, and then. I've always kind of, I check in every so often, you know, I like go to the comic store and look at it. And I ended up getting this comic art on my walls a couple of years ago. And because of that, all of a sudden people give me stuff like that, you know, like Batman figurines. Like,
so you'll be passing all of these things to me now because people, he doesn't really like it. So don't be offended. That he has to pass it on to me.
I'm not crazy about it. It's okay. It's like it's kind of cool, but and I like you know the epic nature of kind of comic
right.
books. It's what's so funny is there's comic books exist on multiple levels, you know. And I think when I was a kid, I really didn't get kind of the deeper side of like say Spider-Man or Iron Man or like the fact that Tony Stark is an alcoholic who's struggling with that and it's part of why he does what he does or I didn't even know the whole Spider-Man thing about his uncle dying and him that whole transformation power set. And it wasn't until I became as an adult where I kind of appreciated that part of it going that's not a very two-dimensional, that's kind of deep, you know, that's pretty cool. And you know, of course it's framed in, you know, kind of in some case silliness or just but in any time, you know, there's always a lot of different levels, a lot of different dimensions. And so I like that part of it. And it's just fun. I think everybody, I certainly as a kid, I wanted to have superpowers or be able to do fly or, you know, have Batman's gadgets or, you know, something. I mean, I think every kid on some level likes that.
You know? If you can have any superpower, what would it be?
That's a hard one.
I'll tell you what my superpower would be. My superpower would be, no matter where I'm at, where whatever country I'm in, I could create money for that country.
Well, I think if you're a Superman, you could fly. And what do you need money for?
Really? Well, because if I'm in like Zimbabwe, I don't have any of their cash. I'm not gonna go exchange
just
my
manifest
money.
Manifest something.
Yeah, like, I'm like, oh, I need $30. Boom, $30 Zimbabwe. Here you go. You know,
well, that would certainly be convenient. Just have a human ATM.
Yeah,
I'm the human ATM
with currency for any place.
Okay. Yeah,
it's an interesting superpower to want.
Yeah,
you know. I like it. I like it.
I know. I think, you know, being able to fly or being invisible, that would be kind of cool.
Invisible, I would just be.
You'd just be hanging out at a strip club.
Yeah. I would really take advantage
of it. At Jamie's house.
I would be at Jamie's house while
all
she's cooking. Or something.
Making popcorn.
Yeah. Make more popcorn. Woo-hoo.
I want to have the power to control liquid.
Okay.
Yeah. Because, you know, everything for me is about,
right,
you know, liquid body healing art.
And humans are made of liquid.
We are. Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know.
You probably do have that power and don't even know it.
I have all sorts of powers.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But I mean, that's probably something you could actually accomplish. You know, I mean, because like you said, we're energy and liquids, water is energy. And we already know that if you talk badly to water, it changes its molecular shape. And if you talk well to it, it changes its molecular. So that's manipulating water. Now, whether it's in a jar or in your body, you mm-hmm. know, that's just location. Really, it has nothing to do with the liquid, you know?
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
I would like to
suck some of that bad water out of me.
Roll it around the world.
There you go.
There we go. That's my superpower.
All
right. What do you think? You like it?
No, I don't. No. I think it's kind of bogus.
I don't care. Well,
I like to be able to breathe underwater. That's kind of limited. So what happens when you're in a place where there's no currency? You know,
every place has currency.
But depends on, you know. Well, like let's say there's a, like back in the after World War II, you know, when all the French francs became worthless and German marks became worthless, all the currency was like cigarettes and cans of beans. You know.
Right. So. When liquid actually is going to be our currency.
What are you talking about?
That's probably exactly what's going to happen.
It could be, because water is more precious than anything.
I'm going to walk in with a jar of water and be like, okay, I'll take 10 pounds of Lay's potato chips.
Yes, we are going to be fighting over liquid.
Okay.
That's what's going to happen.
Me and you should buy glaciers immediately.
I think the thing
glaciers are going to be gone. So.
Well, you could get what you do is solar powered condensing machines that generate that, you know, condense through the air, you know, make water, like your air conditioner, like makes water.
Right.
So that would be your opportunity. But if it was solar powered, then it wouldn't. You could be off the grid and still make it. Right. So there's a possibility.
Until you're away from solar energy. Until you're away from solar energy.
So when you're living underground, that would be rough.
Well, but remember, if when you're exploring like in deep space or wherever, that solar power is only around, you know, our solar system.
That wouldn't work in deep space because you need oxygen and hydrogen in the atmosphere to make that. So that wouldn't work.
One thing at a time.
What kind of water do you drink?
Well, I have a reverse osmosis machine, but then I
get out of here. No way.
I have a reverse osmosis filter, but then it goes. Then I take that and I go into this thing that alkalizes it. So then it's another water filter. It's not a Kagan machine. No, it's actually
another form of it. But it's
it's like that. But it's not. It's not electrolysis. What it does is it goes through a bunch of rocks and minerals. And that's how it. So it's more like it's a little more natural. I'm not really. The Kagan water, and I had another machine like that. I think it was called anyway, it was a cheaper version of a Kagan machine. But the thing about that is, because it's electrically statically charged water that makes it alkaline, over time, you store it. And
Can't store it. You have to drink it.
Exactly. You can't drink it. It goes the charge. But this stuff, because it's minerals in the water. And
that just makes it a mineral process. That's not
it does alkaline.
You can't believe we're talking about water.
Well, it's an important thing to me.
No, I don't know. You put the pH strips in, it actually does break the pH.
Yeah, but it doesn't last for long either. And the plate in the
Kangen, actually.
K-A-N-G-A-N. The Kangen machine, the plates change the molecular structure of the molecule So your body is absorbing that
right.
quicker. So your brain is absorbing it and you're hydrating
and you're right.
at a rapid pace. Whereas, you know, something that's put over and it has a different pH, it's not changing the structure of the water.
Oh,
so,
I see.
You know,
so I should have got that little machine. I'll tell you one thing that was interesting. I was drinking.
I don't sell the machines. I'm just saying.
You should.
One thing that was interesting that I had, back to experiences, I was drinking like, I was getting the pH up to about like 9 plus 10 all the time. That's
too high. That's too high.
It was too high because what would happen was I would drink it and all of a sudden my food wasn't digested.
Right.
Because of all the stomach acid in my stomach was being neutralized by the alkalinity, you know? And all of a sudden I was like, going, oh, this doesn't feel good.
Bad.
No, I learned that the hard way.
8.5. That's
is it the highest you go? Mm-hmm. Okay. There you go.
Yeah, the doctor stuff. No, sorry.
Ross, now, the last question before we let you go. I always like to ask this of the final guest. And that was, you got to sit in and watch the entire experience and then go through the experience yourself.
Oh, that's true, yes. That's right.
Tell me a little bit about that. What have you learned? What did you like? Did you enjoy?
What did I learn? Well, I mean, it was neat to hear what the other guests had to say about what they were up to, you know. And I learned about the 7-string violin, from a low B-flat to a high E, you know.
Yeah.
Citrings, awesome. Tuned in fifths. That was pretty neat.
Yeah, I
love it. Yeah. I'm a bass player, so we're in fourths, so it's a different deal, you know. But you know, I like the. I learned about your manscaping. That was
disturbing.
No, you know, so funny. Kinda, you know, I don't have enough chest hair to be cool.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, so I just but you know, it's funny. One time I was doing this jazz gig. I had this one singer. She used to book us in all these strange places. And one of the strange places, we used to play this gay bar in Long Beach called Ripples. You know, this is probably in the like 90s. Anyhow, so I'm doing this gay bar gig, right? And it was like, we had a steady. We were like there every freaking, it was always during the day too. Like it was Sunday afternoon. You know?
Odd time.
Yeah, you know. We did we used to do ladies night though on Thursday. That was interesting. But anyway, but the point of the story queens? Is, huh?
Drag queens?
No, girls.
Real girls. Really?
Just girls hitting on girls.
Awesome.
It was all girls.
That sounds
right.
Yeah, you know, there were some pretty girls that pop in there too, and it was kind of, well, that's, you know. Anyhow, but the point of the story is, I remember one time I'm playing, and I see this guy trotting by, and he's got, like, perfectly groomed body hair, you know? I remember thinking to myself, you know, that's never occurred to me, because I'm not gay. So, like, perfectly groomed body hair. It's just not in my orbit of like...
That's metrosexual. That's not gay.
Well, he was very gay. He was in a gay bar. I mean...
He was gay.
The chances are pretty good.
I'm trying to save you here.
And he was all, like, he was this buff guy who was all, like, perfectly groomed body hair, and I thought... And of course, it was daytime, so they're like walking around with their shirts off all the time, you know. And
they should.
I guess. I mean, if it turns you on, of course. It wasn't doing anything for me, you know. I had one other fun experience while I was playing there one time. I'm soloing, doing my thing, you know. And in the corner of my eye, I see this thing prancing up towards the stage. It was prancing, very much so. And there's this little gay guy, this little black guy, and wearing a little frilly shirt. And he starts stuffing dollar bills down my shirt as I'm soloing. That's never happened before or since, but that was an experience. That was pretty weird. And I had to laugh. I mean, what can you do? You know, I kind of...
say thank you.
I guess. I mean, I just kind of laughed. I was laughing and, you know, it was... I guess it's a flattering thing, you know, having a guy shove dollar bills down your shirt. It wasn't really what I was looking for, but...
On a Sunday.
Just in general. I don't think any time was that really part of the... you know, hope today somebody, you know, no. Anyway, so
I always wondered about that. You know, like there's a lot of bartenders who work down on Santa Monica, and they're not gay. They work at these gay bars, and how that is for them. They're ever offended or
get them on the show.
You could be a gay bartender.
I wouldn't mind. I mean, why not? If someone wants to hire me. I'll work nights.
Mm-hmm.
I'm available Wednesday through Friday and possibly Sunday
for about 3 hours. You know, right. Well, 7 to 10.
I am looking for another job. I mean,
so there you go.
I do need a night gig. I'm not gonna lie. I'm barely making ends meet with my current job, and by ends meet meaning I'm still living at home with my parents. not even paying. I'm barely making it by with gas, you know. So I am looking for a second job.
And a girlfriend.
And a girlfriend. You think about it. You can have all of this.
And this.
All this
and
potential.
Manscaped.
And I manscaped. Are you into guys at Manscaped?
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, you want
to. Are you into, like, a lot of hair on your man?
No.
No?
Not really.
Okay. That's good, because really. I'm not hairy.
Okay. Ross seems available.
Yeah. Just can't be crazy.
If I have to, you know, take care of myself all the time, then you should do.
There you go. That seems only fair.
Do you take care of yourself? Do you have a hardwood floor or a landing strip?
I thought you knew. I thought you just saw a video.
It was soft porn. Softcore.
Yeah, and it was a fantasy. So yeah. in your fantasy, how am I?
Well, in all my fantasies, all the girls are always hard. That's just, you know.
Yeah. I've never heard that term.
No?
No, but I get it.
Yeah. It's always hard.
Okay.
Thank you, Ross, for coming on the
show.
My
pleasure. That's quite an experience. Absolutely. Nothing else.
Yeah. Hence the experience. Ross-Wright.com. And, of course, the Orchestre Surreal.
Yes, that's just Orchestra with an E.
Yeah. Ross.com. I will have all the links on the show notes. And we shall leave you now with Concerto for Tenor Sax. The first movement, movement noir.